How's it going, bookworms, filmsters? I'm Katana, and welcome back to another BVM. I'm sorry that this one took quite a while, but the whole process of this review almost killed me. Like, the entire time when I was reading it, watching it, I just kept thinking to myself, why? I mean, this was the latest request that most of you guys wanted me to review, but why? I mean, I'm just reading the book, I'm watching the movie, and I'm just thinking, is this just to troll me, or was there actual praise for this book? Because, wow, you're going to see my thoughts in a second, but just okay, well, like I said, this entire process made me question my life as a YouTube critic. So, Divergent by Veronica Roth. Let's read. Long ago, somewhere in the world, it was to believe that the personalities of humans were to be the cause of war and chaos. Not race, or nationalism, or even religion. At the core, it was natural behavior to blame. So they found a way, probably genocide, to eradicate all the bad qualities until 5 traits were left. Abnegation represents selflessness with a collective group of gray-suited pushovers. Amity represents peace-loving hippies who handle the farming. Candor are a group too honest for their own good. The Dauntless maintain security with incredible parkour and rebellious spirit. And lastly, Erudite hold all the intelligence and knowledge. These 5 factions have maintained the state of the world with peace and equality, with only Abnegation leading the entire government. And somehow, this sort of imbalance hasn't led to a war the minute it was announced. But who cares about history, right? Our story is focused on a 16-year-old Abnegation girl named Beatrice, daughter of an Abnegation leader. It is her time to participate in the choosing ceremony, which will give her the chance to pick the faction she's best suited for based on her aptitude test. Her results were inconclusive as she's recommended 3 different factions: Abnegation, Erudite, Dauntless. This phenomenon only happens to a select few, the few who can't be tied down to a single trait. They are different. They are divergent. Why did I make it dramatic? I don't know, but hot damn, do we got some characters to talk about, and we really need to talk about them. Beatrice Pryor is our lead protagonist for this journey, the black sheep of her own faction because she doesn't seem nearly as selfless as her family, always has to be reminded to help, second best to her perfect brother Caleb. She's playing the generic role of being different from everyone around her and having that gut feeling of wanting more. To put it in simpler terms, she's basic. It's easy to say that Beatrice doesn't have a personality than to go looking for one. Probably the funniest thing was finding the chapter where she says she had a sarcastic sense of humor and doesn't show that personality within that scene. There is sarcasm later on in the story, but it's as bland as the color palette of her hometown. However, when she finally joins her new faction, which is Dauntless, there's an actual transformation going on for her character. It's both progressive and frustrating at the same time, if you could believe that. While there are certain scenes and chunks of paragraphs to show her slowly getting immersed with this faction, like the ziplining and customs of Dauntless, there are also dumb moments that take a step back. Like after halfway with the initiation, she's still complaining about the treatment, even after everything she's been subjected to at that point. Also, she's kind of an asshole. Judging people by the way they look, flip-flopping when she wants to have friends and doesn't, it gets to a point where it's the writing deciding her feelings rather than the natural flow of her character growth. And then we got 4. I mean, I don't even want to think about this dude. Like, seriously, out of all the YA characters I've reviewed so far, this has to be the most disappointing one to read, because how can you turn such a cool, ruthless teen into such a little... 4 is a Dauntless member training these new transfers in the ways of the faction. He's introduced as a mystery, a guy that's strong in presence but compassionate when it's called for. And there's a lot of favoritism towards Beatrice, obviously, but that also means she gets even more brutal treatment, which she doesn't mind sometimes. She hates him and strangely likes him for it. But overall, in this universe, 4 displays a sense of coolness and the prime example of a Dauntless soldier. But you screw them, Rod! You screwed them! Everything was decent up to the second stage where the initiatives had to conquer the fears inside their heads. Beatrice follows 4 to the chamber where they perform the simulation in the middle of the night, and he allows her to go into his fear landscape. I was really curious about what Four's fears might be, but incredibly disappointed by what was actually written. That image of a strong and fearless team was replaced quickly with someone so weak and feeble, and it makes no sense. I mean, he's done this how many times now? I would assume he'd be used to these fears by now. Not only this, but the fact that it feels like the whole scene was created just to let Beatrice take the lead annoyed the hell out of me. It's his world. I would have imagined him saying something along the lines of, "No, I have to do this on my own." But he doesn't. She kinda takes control and hogs the spotlight, which seems like cheating because he's not conquering the fear on his own. He invited her to enter his head, so I thought he might have been able to show her the right way to do this without divergent influence, but I was mistaken. And after this whole experience, he starts to show his sensitive side and reveal that he's not cool after all. I don't care if this guy ends up being the hero of the entire series, I am never going to forget what this scene did to him, and the final push for this forced romance.
False romance in my YA novel.
Ha! Well, we'll actually get to that later, but let me just cover the rest of the flat characters. Caleb Pryor is Beatrice's brother who's known to be very generous and wise within his family. Wise enough to pursue that intellectual side of his and join Erudite, which holds bad blood with abnegation. So you can feel how their dad must feel losing both his kids to Smarties and Parkour City. Beatrice also makes some friends like Christina, a Kandor transfer who's pretty blunt with her honesty and can tell when someone is lying, and Will, the Erudite boy with all the quick wit and funniness of the group. She's got her enemies as well. Eric, like Four, is also training these initiatives, but his way is more brutal and is looking to create killers than soldiers. And then we got Peter, another Kandor transfer who rivals with Beatrice on gaining the top ranking in their initiative. He's more than a bully, he's psychotic. Jammed a fork in another kid's eyeball because he was second best. If that doesn't seem crazy, then you hang out with him, see where that goes. The only character who I felt had the best development was another Kandor transfer named Al. He was large in size, but big hearted as well. He wasn't combat oriented, but still had the main crew cheering him on. He confessed his true feelings for Beatrice, but she rejected him for his sensitivity. And when his ranking was on the line, he joins up with Peter and goons to assault her in the middle of the night. His character actually went through a lot, way more tears and struggles than I ever felt with Beatrice. I wanted to know how his dauntless journey would end. Would he become strong? Would Beatrice change her mind about him? The endless possibilities that could have been taken with Al. But just screw them, Roth! You screwed him! You just had to kill him off with suicide. And I really can't complain because some characters are destined to play a role no matter how long or short. But when that character has more dimension than 90% of the other ones, including the protagonist, you know you did something wrong. I'll just jump right into the cons and explain my reasons for why this book almost made me want to die. For starters, the entire manuscript feels like a first draft that accidentally got published. Seriously, I found a handful of grammatical errors, mixed up words, and repeated sentences. The details were so dry I had to blow away sand on every page flip. Her elbow prods one of my sore muscles. I have more sore muscles than not sore muscles. And this is the kind of world building that I needed to dive deeper into the specifics because it's vague and opens up too many questions. The main one being about divergence. If it's not wanted because these people harbor more than one of the five initial traits, making them uncontrollable, why allow them the chance to transfer to other factions? Wouldn't adding on to what they previously learned about their old faction make them divergent? This whole system is creating the one thing it's set out to destroy. Also, comparing this to the Hunger Games is an insult to the Hunger Games. I mean, the Hunger Games had a strong introduction, a decent training program, and the actual Hunger Games. This story, on the other hand, just jumps right into the plot so you don't get any kind of character introduction, and the main conflict isn't something to look forward to, and it stretches the training program for 500 pages. Dude! Divergent. It's painfully slow. Now don't get me wrong, I can get behind stories that want to add some contemporary fiction, which I understood from Beatrice's search for identity, but it's categorized as a dystopian adventure as well. In theory, the Dauntless are supposed to be the more exciting and adrenaline-filled faction, but it doesn't feel that unique or make the world stand out from our own. I can parkour if I want to, I can jump off a moving train, ziplining, paintballing, but when you continue to read on, you start to notice the most important aspect for Roth's story, more important than action or setting. You know what's worse than a forced romance? A romance that just
has no reason being there. I mean, it's obvious that Roth wanted a love story, which is fine. It's fine. But I just thought the search for belonging needed more attention, at least for the first book. She could have developed Four and Beatrice's relationship in the sequel, but nope, it had to be done pronto. And when the choice came between love and action, nothing sets a more perfect example than the paintball scene.
First, I should say that this chapter deserved a split. It's 30 pages long and incredibly unbalanced. To break it down, the initiatives are woken up to participate in a late paintball game. They go to a remote location, separate into groups, argue about the next step. Beatrice takes it upon herself to climb a Ferris wheel and gather their surroundings with Four tagging along. They find the location of the other team and make an attack on their base, thus winning the game. Now, can you tell me how much time was spent for each scene? 90% on Triss and Four climbing the damn Ferris wheel and about 4 pages of actual paintballing. Literally, 30 pages of Triss and Four having a date, not even riding the damn thing, and when it came to going against the other team, it's so lazy, it hurts. Simply writing they went there and won would have been more descriptive. The chapter could have easily been split into two, making one dedicated to establishing teamwork, develop new friends or enemies, but no. Triss and Four, climbing up a wheel. Best chapter ever.
But what really pisses me off more about this book is that it just feels insulting.
This was probably not the intention, but it gives off the impression of someone who thinks, oh, writing a book isn't so hard. So they wrote one and it instantly became a hit. Can you tell me, writers, how much work is put into a manuscript? As agonizing as the research is and going back to polish a certain scene or draft, it's done so that it could be read with clarity and comes off the way the writer intended. So why? Why did this one get so much praise? Research tells me that it was just running on the bandwagon of YA dystopians, but even so, did no one look at this and say, what the fuck? This is incomplete. This doesn't feel finished at all. Were agencies so blinded by the hype that they couldn't see what passed as good or not?
She had to have had some connections on the inside because, my god, this is unbelievable.
But of course, I'm going to complete the series. I heard that the sequels expand more on the lore and flaws from this book. I'm hoping Roth realized what she produced in Divergent and managed to actually spend some time on her world. But this is the same kind of wishful thinking I did with the Maze Runner series, and we all saw where that led to. I can't dance this dance again, but I'm willing to give it 5% of a second chance. Anyways, I think my stance is pretty clear in this book. If you have never read a YA novel and found this in the corner of your eye, my child, please, go straight for the one that this book tailed, come back to this, and see the comparison in terms of character, story, and romance. And I know I'm going to get hate for this, I can already see it in my head, for not reading the entire series and not understanding how good it's going to get in the future, but can we all just hold hands? Can we all just sing Kumbaya under the moonlit stars and agree that this series had a piss poor start? Nothing will make me happier if we could all just agree on this one fact.
So those are my thoughts on the book portion, and it was not a good time. I mean, I feel like I read enough YAs to finally sort out that this is just another generic and awfully bland dystopian. But maybe the movie might change my mind. Did it do better? Worse? I don't know. Let's just sit back and relax as we figure out this enigma with Neil Berger's Divergent.
So our movie begins with some gorgeous wide shots of a dystopian Chicago with different factions walking around. Funny how in order to achieve peace, people needed to be segregated by colors and groups. We then have our heroine Beatrice talk about her home and the different factions that exist. Erudite living a life of test tubes, Emily living in eternal happiness, Candor living in the courtrooms, Dauntless living on the extreme, and Abnegation living a selfless, charitable life, making them suitable to run the entire government without any opposition from the other factions.
Oh, Rod, you innocent soul, you. You do know it takes more than kindness to run a city, right?
We finally see our protagonist through the only mirror they own, trying to calm her nerves about the aptitude test determining what faction she'll go to. But there's really no suspense as we already saw a snippet of her younger self running with Dauntless and climbing the roof of her own home. Then we meet her brother Caleb, the selfless one of the two. They walk towards the testing area in which she gives us another reminder about these factions, in case you've forgotten this far in. I know, 3 minutes is too crazy to ask for someone's attention. And the movie also introduces Peter early on, which is great because Miles Teller is taking the role. Just listen to this bashing. It almost sounds like a stand-up routine.
So, all the food that we're not getting, you guys are giving away to the factionless, right? Yeah?
Yeah.
You're a liar. Why are you lying to me? Everybody knows you keep it for yourselves, so why don't you just admit it?
Not long, the Dauntless are coming out from the running train and get in line for testing.
Oh man, I really don't know what she's going to pick. Can't put a finger on it. Amity? Nah. Kandor could be a good fit.
Before it begins, the teens are subjected to a pep talk explaining that these tests really don't matter because you could just choose any faction that pleases you. They're more like suggestions. So Beatrice enters the room with a giant mirror looking back at her.
What is it with you, abnegation and mirrors?
We reject vanity.
Yeah, I know. Sit down.
Then why did you ask, asshole? The Dauntless volunteer Tori sets Beatrice up nice and tight, giving her a mysterious blue drink and transporting her into a simulation. 100 reflections surround her until one of them tells her to choose between a knife and steak. In the book, she practically refuses after being asked so many times, but the movie doesn't even wait and sends Cujo after her. She then gives her body up as the doggo's chew toy, resulting in turning it into a cute pup, until the simulation brings in a third wheel, getting the dog riled up again. This time, Beatrice shows her true colors and jumps the dog, bringing her back into the real world.
You're going to tell your family that the serum made you sick and that I sent you home, alright?
No, but what was my result?
Abnegation. And erudite. And Dauntless. Your results were inconclusive.
That's impossible. It doesn't make any sense.
Not impossible. It's just extremely rare.
Wow! It's as if humans are made up of complex emotions and depending on the circumstance can adapt to the situation quickly with the appropriate response.
The book goes into more details about her scores, but it just makes it more confusing. For one, there was a second test about talking with a stranger on the bus, and the way she lied ruled her out as being Kandor. But I think that they should have added more tests to get a stronger indication of her trait. It's like taking the personality test with the only question being, what's your horoscope? So, with multiple choices, she's considered divergent, which she can't tell anyone about. Beatrice is then kicked out and sent home early. She spots a couple of factionless, one that actually apprehends her in the book, but it never comes back and it becomes pointless. Back home, Beatrice is trying to avoid the awkward conversation of being more than the small town abnegation gal. At the dinner table, we get word of Erudite wanting to take over as supreme leader because of some allegations about Marcus being the piece of shit. And how could you even fathom the idea? Intelligence and selflessness working together to make the world more peaceful? Bullocks, I say.
For tomorrow. I am. We love you.
Hey, hey, hey! This is the wholesome abnegation household. Get that Amity crap out of my face.
Under the tone of an unfitting music choice, Beatrice and her family head towards the Great Choosing Ceremony, where we meet erudite Janine Matthews. The book only mentions her by name early on, with the tension created around abnegation and the allegations, but the movie slaps a face to Matthews as she'll be popping up more frequently. Like Caleb, she reminds Beatrice that the choice is hers to make, which is a bold statement that really contradicts this whole system. If you grew up one faction and are allowed to join another, then you qualify for a mix of different thoughts, making you divergent. It's not like you automatically forget your roots. That's not how experience works. But anyways, the ceremony commences. They do their speech, say their motto.
Faction before blood.
And proceed to dip their blood into their one true faction. After a couple of loyalties and abandonments, Caleb takes the stand.
Erudite.
I don't know if people knew how erudite Caleb was in telling Beatrice to think of her own family while he went off to pursue his own life.
Oh, but Beatrice shows him by choosing Dauntless and leaving her parents childless. She takes one glance at her parents giving her the look of shame before she flips at sorrow and joins her new Dauntless brothers with glee. Her first task is to climb the scaffold of the train railings, and once she gets up there, the train's coming but it's not stopping. All the Dauntless know when to jump. But Beatrice...
Oh, honey. Beatrice finally gets on the train and meets with her first transfer friend, Christina, played by the gorgeous Zoe Kravitz. And before you know it, they get to parkour again, this time from the train to the rooftop. And I'm guessing all of them made it because there's no attention to the select few who failed immediately in the book. The initiatives gather and listen to one of the Dauntless members, Eric, talk about jumping into the heart of Dauntless headquarters.
We just jumped. They want us to jump again.
No, Christina, do not underestimate the Dauntless' will to jump. It's practically the whole movie. Everyone is agape by the fact that this stiff is willing to be the first to jump. She takes the leap and lands on a net, being helped out by another Dauntless leader, Four. He gives her the option of choosing another name, thus leading to the birth of Triss. Also, this is a pretty lame crowd in comparison to the book.
First jumper, Triss. Welcome to Dauntless.
Four instructs his transfer students that he'll be overlooking their training and gives them a quick tour around the headquarters. And if you thought this movie couldn't be less saturated, their underground cave is bleached to the bone. Hell, I wouldn't have minded brown. A dirt brown cave. This looks like an addition to Abnegation or something. Four then brings them to their sleeping quarters, and co-ed, nonetheless. He leaves them to change into Dauntless attires, burn away their previous faction, and enter a generic high school cafeteria for feasting. There is some good character development here, with Triss getting to know her friends, including Al and Will, but there's Four ruining all the fun.
Were you a transfer too? Or Dauntless born?
Are you kidding? What makes you think you can talk to me?
I mean, you're pretty casual in the book, so we just assumed. Then everyone in the cafeteria starts clapping their tin cans as the bigger leader arrives to welcome the new initiatives by lifting them off their feet and applauding. This is a quality I didn't expect from this faction, but it does carry a certain charm. Although they might be seen by the rest like security brutes, they have a ton of compassion towards their own, and the book really emphasizes that quality. Next morning, Four calls the transfers to the pit, getting ready for training. Eric goes over the ranking system that will determine who will be members and who will be sent home factionless. This motivates the initiatives to do their best and train into superb warriors. So far, the movie's been pretty rushed trying to cram in as much of the book into the movie adaption, but in the case of montages, it does a great job. Which leads right into the final segments of these sessions. In the book, the first official duel was between Al and Will, which did a lot to develop Al's sensitive nature and his stance to not fight. Even most of the dialogue is pulled from that fight.
How long do we fight for?
Till one of you can't continue,
or one of you concedes.
According to the old rules.
But we focus on Triss, as if she didn't have enough attention already. She's up against Big Molly, I believe. She's decked in one punch and pretty much establishes how this first half of training is going to go.
If you're still in the red by the end of the first stage, you're out.
Personally, I like how the book kept the suspense by not keeping the scoreboard of the rankings, but this seems like a much more excellent way as motivation for the initiatives, especially those in red, to get their ass in gear. After defeating Day of Training, the transfer gang decide to put their minds on getting a tattoo, and Triss finds the same volunteer from the aptitude test, Tori. She gets a tattoo, suppressing the meaning behind it, and tries getting answers, but Tori only warns her about the dangers of choosing Dauntless. Well, maybe you shouldn't have given her the option then? I mean, you could have just said that Erudite and Abnegation, like, or Candor even, like, if they were inconclusive, you could have just lied. Afterwards, we get a quick snippet of Triss working overnight to get herself out of the red zone. This is probably the most enjoyable segment of the movie. They're pretty short, but just focus on their evolution through the work. There's actual progress being made here. Plus, if you slap a logo on there, it almost looks like a really cool motivational video. But just as I'm starting to like this independent growth of hers, Ford just has to pass by with his sexual advances.
You're weak. You have no muscle. You're never gonna win, not like that.
That's good to know.
Yep, you have to use your whole body. Keep tension here.
Oh, you heard me right. Sexual advances. On the other side of the room, Christina fights with Big Molly until she succumbs to defeat. Eric takes notice and invites everyone on a little field trip. To death! The book had a better waterfall aesthetic, but the dread is all the same. Christina needs to hang for 3 minutes getting through her fear. I'll admit that there was some good tension here, with no help from Triss's lackluster concern.
Come on, Chris.
And I think this scene acts as evidence for the pacing problem. 3 minutes pass, Tris and Al help Christina, and then immediately jumps to the next scene. And the book is a little at fault for this as well. Isn't Christina important enough to have some focus for this moment? It was pretty traumatic and might have changed her attitude moving forward with the initiation. But the movie's more concerned with shoving all the cool scenes and exposition than providing strong characterization. Or better threats.
What's out there? Monsters. Do you know?
Let's just say they built defense for a reason.
Next scene starts perfecting their aim with knives. Tris has got the knack for it while Al is putting out some sloppy work. He complains about going into the target area to retrieve his knives, and Eric forces him to stand as a target for Four to practice on. If he flinches, he's factionless. The book's Eric had a lot more going on than being a generic asshole, because this scene happens after the results of the paintball scene in the book, and he was just taking his anger out on people. That's a lot more scary. But it stays true to Tris taking over for Al and standing in place as Four gives her a little taste of his power and the nick off the ear.
You meant to?
I think he was gonna let you off without a scratch. I'd still be standing there if I hadn't hit you.
So am I supposed to thank you?
The book takes this conversation a little further and makes Tris sound stupid. She calls him sadistic for this, as if he gutted her in the stomach or something. Either way, this moment gave her some credit. Even Big Molly is saying that she looked cool. But Peter's putting a damper on her parade by reading an article about Tris's dad and how even his own kids didn't want to be part of abnegation. I mean, no mirrors and hamburgers, what'd you expect? And then the gang walks away to run into Janine Matthews once again. Nothing interesting is said, just a little nod that she's around. Totally not suspicious. Let's just go to the next scene of Tris going against Peter. And I'm really happy for it, because Miles got a lot more action here than in Fanforstic. Tris is easily outmatched and watches Four walk away. Maybe because she didn't cheat right.
First shot, right to the throat, and you watch him. He steps before he punches.
Peter kicks her so hard she falls back to a memory. Not that one, but it might as well be, because this one doesn't visually tell me anything. She wakes up in the medical room being told that she's off the team. She's done. Finesse. She outta here. But Tris doesn't give up so easily, because we still have an hour and a half left. Leer behind. Gun!
Damn it. Who let you out?
I did.
You did? Okay.
That's it? I mean, knowing you, you probably would have made her hang on the train the entire time to prove something, but alright. He must be in a good mood. Ah yes, the paintball scene. Except we ain't playing with paintballs this time.
Call it a gun.
With these neurosim darts, capture the flag is about to commence. Two teams on an abandoned pier. Four's group is busy arguing about what to do with the next step, while Tris decides to go off on her own and climb the Ferris wheel for higher ground. Four follows behind her, mainly for some alone time, and also to exploit the unbreakable Four.
You alright? You're afraid of heights.
Everyone's afraid of something.
Now imagine about 25 pages of this. A long chapter of climbing the wheel, building up a very weak romance, a forced moment of suspense, but with the movie's rapid pacing, we just get them to the top, spot the opponent's flag, and right back into the action, which is done so much better here. The two teams collide with one another, giving Tris and Four a chance to advance. Christina finds herself cornered by Peter until Tris comes around to give him a dart, and then another. Four is up against Eric, proving to be the superior of the two, and then Tris makes her way to the top and enters a duel with Big Molly, somehow exacting her revenge from their previous fight. And dip damn Daru, they capture the flag. Whereas the book, you get none of this, and it quickly summarizes them getting through everyone and capturing the flag without any sense of struggle. The movie dominated this scene. Now this next scene requires a bit of context from the book. Basically, the rankings of the transfers came in with Peter being second to another boy named Edward. He didn't like that, so he stabbed Edward right in the eye with a fork. This scared the crap out of Tris, and knowing this, Yuria, which I'm guessing is this kid here, invites her to hang out with the Dauntless Born initiatives. It was those few moments that shed a different light on the Dauntless people, but the movie doesn't dive that deep and just wants to show a really cool scene. Tris is strapped up and ready to fly, and it's pretty damn beautiful.
Hey, Buzz! You're flying!
This
isn't flying. This is falling with style.
Yep, that is one tall tower, and she's taking her sweet ass time to get back down here. So, we'll take a break right now, and we'll be back for more Divergence. See you guys real soon. Right, we're back, and I think Triss is getting ready for landing. With a crowd waiting at the finish line, Triss pulls the brakes and not a second longer. They return back home where Forrest congratulating her, trying so hard to conceal his lust, and the leader of leaders, I still have no clue who this guy is, giving out the rankings for stage 1 training, with Triss making it second to last. Next morning, Dauntless members are helping out in supplies, while Triss gets a signal from her mother. This is replacing Visitation Day from the book, in which the families of transfers can come and visit their kids, at least if they want to. But her mother is here to warn her about Erudite eliminating Divergence.
What am I? You don't conform. Your mind works in a million different ways. They're scared of you.
Wow. It's as if humans are made up of complex emotions and depending on the circumstance can adapt to the situation quickly with the appropriate response. They're not a new species. They're living in future Chicago. I don't get what exactly changed for them to not have this conformed mindset. In fact, we have plenty of examples of kids not wanting to conform. But anyways, Triss's mom gives her warning and disappears. And we now begin the second stage of training, and wouldn't you know it, it's another simulation. This time, about fears. Ooh. I know that exposure therapy was one of Roth's inspirations to create this story, but everything does feel rehashed and repeated over and over. I'm always waiting for the next big thing, but it either takes a small step or one step backwards. But in comparison with the first simulation, this one does feel more fleshed out as it explores all of Triss's fears, one of them being a swarm of crows attacking her. And this is the thing I want to understand. The thing that makes her divergent is the fact that she knows it's a simulation and can get out of it without conquering her fears. But if you're told beforehand that it's all in your head, does it really make you divergent?
This legitimately confuses me. Like, it's not even a joke. I am seriously confused. And I think it would be cleared up a bit more if I witnessed just more fear landscapes from the other transfer students.
Triss swims right out of there and back into the real world. Gotta say that movie Triss took it a lot more maturely, because book Triss whined and acted like her dauntless life so far wasn't this brutal and difficult. Back in the dorms, the transfer gang is sharing their first day of fear fighting, and Peter, being the all-around instigator, makes Triss feel different from her friends. Also, after an hour, we finally get some indication of Al's growing feelings towards Triss. All I'm saying is, where were you at stage 1? And then we're introduced to Triss's second fear of drowning. Like before, she tells herself that it's not real and cracks the glass open. This time though, Four confronts her about this strange wind by asking for her test results. She continues to push abnegation, but nothing fools Four. Then Triss is talking with Tori about an incident happening to her Divergent brother, but not the important fact from the book that Divergents know when they're in a simulation. I don't know how this segue worked, but her mother told her to visit Caleb whenever she could in the book. It's out of order, which could be said for the majority of events in this movie, but nevertheless.
Hey, Triss.
Triss tries to talk about her not belonging in Dauntless anymore due to her fear of being killed, wishing to go back home. But Caleb took up the faction before Blood Model quick and is now feeling like Erudite should be the ones in charge, which seems more comprehensible than the arrogance he displayed in the book. He tells her to leave but is suddenly stopped by some Erudite thugs, but they aren't Dauntless at all.
Stop! Are you alright?
Yeah, I'm fine.
No, Triss, not you. She's talking to the man you just killed on the stairway. This was the first meeting in the book, playing her to be this big, important figure. But since we've seen her 2 to 3 times now, she almost feels like a friend to Triss at this point. A friend who's given herself too easily for the audience to understand her motives. That is, if they haven't caught on already.
You think that human nature is weakness?
I think human nature is the enemy. It's human nature to keep secrets, lie, to steal. And I want to eradicate that. How we'll maintain a stable, peaceful society.
Janine sends Triss back home in the car, and on her way back to the dorm, she's assaulted by masked men. They remain mysterious until one of them is revealed to be Al, which was much more disheartening in the book due to their evolving relationship. Lucky for her, Ford just so happened to be taking a stroll and kicks all their asses. He brings her back to his room and lets her stay for the night. She's still thinking about Al being part of that group, but Ford reminds her that fear can do a lot of things to people. And thank God he didn't take the book's route of devising the plan to seem weak in front of the other initiatives, because what kind of an example is that? People are afraid of your strength, so the only solution is to put yourselves at their level? Nah, fam, Ford's response here is great.
Fear doesn't shut you down and wakes you up. I've seen it.
Next morning, Triss talks to Ford about the possibility of Erudite overthrowing that negation leadership, but he tells her that she's got other things to worry about, like what to say to Al next time they meet.
I don't know what's wrong with me. Lisa, can you ever forgive me?
If you ever come close to me again, I will kill you.
Triss.
You need to stay away from me. You are a coward.
And that rejection hit him so hard, it literally killed him. I'm still mad about this. I mean, there was so much that could have been done with Al. I mean, siding with the villains, building up some redemption arc. I mean, there's nothing wrong except the waste of a decent character for this series. Ford tries to confront Triss about the suicide, but learns about her other worries of not passing because of her divergence. Then Ford decides to help her by laying her practice within his own fear landscape. This explanation makes much more sense than the book laying her in because of reasons. And since this is his landscape, he's the one leading because of the many times he must have done this. In the book, she's taking control while he's being a little... The movie understands keeping his masculinity and strong nature in mind. He doesn't bitch out. He stays composed and goes through all his fears with ease until it's the last one.
Marcus had a son.
Tobias. 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 Just trying to help you to be better.
Oh yeah, and he's Marcus' son, confirming the allegations from the beginning of the movie. Sorry, this should have been the big twist, but the entire scene from the book, it really bothered me. God damn it.
They talk afterwards about his nickname representing his four fears, and the tattoo he wears on his back showcasing all the factions, low-key wishing he was Divergent. And then they kiss. The book stays focused on this romance for a while, even adds some weak drama, but the movie doesn't. What we need to focus on is the stakeout Ford's been doing on Erudite. Now we arrive to the final evaluation, the make it or break it point to become a full-fledged Dauntless. Within her simulation, she manages to find a fearless solution that doesn't involve her wishing it all away. Some fears didn't make it from the book, but I think maybe one of them wasn't relevant. And I didn't even notice the fire pole the first time, so that was cool.
But I think the music did not need to be this intense. I mean, she's clogging up a pipe, for God's sakes.
The last one, though, is the fear I got to applaud the most, her new fear of Tobias. And there's a distinct difference between the book and movie. I didn't take the book seriously during this part because of how she worded her fear of love. And don't get me wrong, it's a legitimate fear. Fear of commitment, fear of a broken condom. But by the end, she conquers it by gaining control of the situation and then making out with him. Visually, the movie makes a legitimate fear by enhancing the lack of consent.
Stop. Ford.
Aren't you Dauntless?
Ladies, do yourself a favor, take this advice. If you ever come across a man who looks you dead in the eyes and says those exact words, zip up the gooch and get the F out of there. You'll be doing yourself a favor, trust me.
Movie Triss does a sensible thing and punches her way out, leading her back into reality. Except that it's not reality, and the movie trolled you with one last test. Janine asks Triss to shoot her family, and thinking very hard about the life without mirrors, she takes the shot, bringing her back to Ford. And just a straightaway cut, they are deemed Dauntless. The celebration is dumbed down into nothing, and the groups find themselves standing in line to receive a tracker. Eric does Triss a favor and does it himself, leading right into the middle of the night, where all the soldiers are now mindless zombies. Because Triss is Divergent, the injection doesn't affect her, nor the other Divergent walking through the scene.
Hey. Everything's fine, there's nothing to worry about.
They all get in the train and make their way towards the abnegation sector. Triss walks towards the front, standing next to Four and confirming that the man didn't take him down yet. The book had this all go down in the middle of the night, but seeing this in broad daylight is Honestly, a nice change. But the mission is still the same. Dauntless soldiers drag innocent abnegation members out of their home, pushing them to different locations, or just flat out killing them on the spot. Four and Triss go looking for her parents, but they're nowhere to be found. And when they start moving outside, Eric takes a good look at Four and suspects that he might be faking it.
There's one way to find out.
Goodbye.
Move when you die.
The stiff? She's not gonna shoot me.
I think you might be overestimating my character.
Triss, come on. Let's be real. What character? Eric is down for the count and the two try making a run for it. They're easily caught and brought to meet with Janine, who says that abnegation will destroy the faction system, but never saying how, and instead blames human nature for destroying the peace. She ends up taking Four with her and lets Triss be executed. By luck, she's rescued by her mother, who now reveals herself to be a Dauntless transfer. The mother-daughter duo band together to take out some soldiers until it is Will who arrives at the scene. Okay, this was a really pointless death. I mean, you shot Eric, that didn't kill him, so why don't you do the same for Will? I mean, you could have shot him in the arms or leg. We know you got the aim for it. This is so stupid, it hurts to even think about. But don't get too emotional yet, because in less than a minute, her mom goes down too. I really wish they shared a little more screen time that wasn't exposition, otherwise I might have gave more of a damn. But anyways, Triss escapes the mindless soldiers and finds a group of abnegation hiding out. She meets back with her dad and Caleb, and even scumbag Marcus. She tells him about the soldier stuck in the simulation, and the only way to stop it is by destroying the signal back at Dauntless. So we rush back on the train with these noobs trying to get on Dauntless level, until they finally reach a stopping point, Peter holding guard. That is, until Triss shoots him for saying something dumb.
Where are they controlling it from?
Why would I tell you that? It's not like you're gonna shoot me.
Why do people keep saying that?
Peter leads the group to where the simulation is being controlled, and by his own volition, Triss's dad decides to take the lead and shoot the group standing outside. They do the job, but at the cost of officially becoming an orphan. She leaves Caleb and Marcus behind as she sneaks right into the heart of the operation. She finds Four strapped up in a chair, and when she breaks him out, he turns on her. Thanks to Janine, Four is under a serum effective against Divergence, and with the right calculations, engages in the fight against Triss. The choreography looks alright, and every hit does feel like it hurts, but the resolution sucks.
It's okay. It's okay. It's okay.
How does she do it? Well, it's simple. With Four back in control of his thoughts, he takes out the bodyguards while Triss deals with Janine and her plans. I would say that this climax is much better than the book now that Janine is standing in the way of stopping the attack. With quick thinking, Four hands Triss the serum and she injects it into Janine, making her shut down the program. She's decked out in one punch and Triss and Four start making their escape. They regroup with the others and start running towards the train. One by one, they all make it inside, realizing that they have no home or faction to go back to, but they got each other. And that's all that matters. As they ride into the distance, Divergent finally comes to an end. Okay, so the movie. Not that different from the book. I'll give it credit for staying true to the original source, if that's any consolation, but yeah, neither the book or movie gave me a strong, solid, good impression. I mean, it was a still journey with nothing to come back to except the dreadful day where I do come back to complete this series. But if I had to choose right now, book did it a smidge better. There are just a few things I did like about the movie. The montages did well to summarize most of Triss's journey. The capture flag scene was given the screen time it deserved, and Four actually remained a solid warrior in my eyes. There were a few nice shots here and there, including some of the simulation scenes. But the reason why the book worked is because even though I don't agree how it felt like she rolled out of bed to write a book, at least I could see that Roth had a story in mind. There were moments of character growth and time to personalize the faction beyond its strength. The initial
initial plan of controlling Dauntless along with motives was happening under the training, which did not go unnoticed. Regardless of my own personal feelings and thoughts, Rod seemed like she had a faint idea as to where this story was going to go. The movie, however, didn't give me that same feeling. The majority of the movie felt like a compilation of highlight moments that happened in the story. The zipline scene, capture the flag, the assault, Janine's plan, the fights, the deaths, it's all there, but it doesn't feel as connected or substantial like the book.
It might be hard for people who just saw the movie, but for fans of the book who actually read it, you had to have noticed how fast paced it was to move on to the next major recognizable scene.
Hey, I didn't even like the book at all, but even I can admit I felt something from time to time. Al's character development was pretty much the only aspect I was looking forward to, but it wasn't there. They started to introduce his lust for Triss an hour in, and it wasn't for the sake of creating real development, but because it was part of the story. Another moment was when Christina hung for dear life on the edge of a ravine, and there's no real way of knowing how it affected her because the scene moves on from it. Nothing on her perspective or how this might have changed the way she handled these challenges. The movie's focus is showing you all the cool scenes from the book, but without the proper narrative. The book was clumsy too, but I knew why things happened and how things were going to be.
And this is really all I can say about it.
I can tell you it's a good adaptation since not much was changed from the book, but I can't find the appeal in this. Probably during this time, it must have been the ship because as much as you want to deny it, it rode the coattail of the Hunger Games. This is the product of a bandwagon, which definitely needed more attention. An idea that deserved a little more time to grow, which is what I'm hoping from the sequels. I'm not a bad guy, I'll give Insurgent a chance, but right after I recover from this introduction. So don't let me down, Roth. My hope is in your hands now.
With that said, those are my final thoughts on Divergent. And if you don't agree, you can read the book, watch the movie, and make your own opinions. I'm Katana, and we'll be back with a stronger story. A piece full of history, terror, and no parkour. I'll see you all in the next review. Take care, guys.
A quick shout out to my Patreon supporters, including our newest member, Crystalline. Thank you guys for having my back. This couldn't be possible without the generosity. Anyways, thank you all for watching today's review. If you can, help a brother out by sharing this video with friends and family. And if you haven't already, subscribe and ring-a-ling that bell to stay updated on future reviews. Thought this review was a little too extreme for the mind's eye? Well, why not take a slower step by watching my last review on Charlie St. Cloud? It's got Ghost Boys if that piques your interest. Got a book slash movie review you'd like to see me do one day? Just leave a suggestion in the comments down below and I'll be sure to check it out. Roth, if you just so happen to be watching, let me know who you know on the inside. I got a couple drafts here that seem ready for the big leagues. If you can, shout me out. Give me a holler. Later.